JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's Daily Market Review for October the 2nd. I am Charalambos Pissouros, Senior Market Analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar traded higher against all but one of the other G10 currencies on Thursday and during the Asian morning Friday. It gained the most versus the pound, NOK and the Aussie, while it was found virtually unchanged against the Kiwi. The strengthening of the greenback suggests that financial markets traded in a risk-off fashion, but the fact that the Kiwi was also strong suggests otherwise. Thus, in order to clear things up, we prefer to turn our gaze to the equity world. Here, most EU and US indices closed in positive territory, with Nasdaq gaining the most, 1.42%, driven again by market leaders such as Amazon, Microsoft and Apple. The exception was DAX, which slid 0.23%, weighed down by a 13.1 slump in Bayer after the firm signaled that adjusted profit may decline in 2021 and that it is likely to write down the value of agricultural assets by nearly 10 billion euros. Sentiment was softer during the Asian session today, with Japan's Nikkei 225 falling 0.72%, following headlines that US President Donald Trump was tested positive for the coronavirus. China's, Hong Kong's and South Korea's markets remained closed. Despite most indices trading again in the green, we repeat that we are reluctant to trust a long-lasting recovery. COVID infections continue to rise at a fast pace, with yesterday's new global cases nearing their record, which adds to concerns over more lockdown measures around the globe. Madrid is the first capital to go back into lockdown, while a British health minister introduced more coronavirus restrictions across a wider area of England. On top of COVID, another source of concern may be the US election, scheduled to take place on November 3rd. As we get closer to the election day, investors may start getting more nervous. Having said all that, though, now market attention is likely to fall on the US employment report for September, due out later today. NFPs are forecast to have increased by 850,000, less than August's 1.371 million, but still a solid number which is consistent with further improvement in the labor market. The unemployment rate is expected to have declined more, to 8.2% from 8.4%, while average hourly earnings are forecast to have accelerated somewhat to 4.8% year over year from 4.7%. At its most recent meeting, the FOMC kept interest rates kept its policy unchanged, but changed its inflation language, noting that they will aim to achieve inflation moderately above 2% for some time, so that inflation averages 2% over time. With regards to the new economic projections, officials revised up their GDP and inflation forecasts and downgraded the unemployment rate once. While the new dot plot suggested that interest rates are likely to stay at present levels at least through 2023. That said, looking at the details, we see that one member was in favor of a hike in 2022 and four members saw rates higher in 2023. Combined with the inflation forecast of 2023, which is at 2%, this shows that some members may not be willing to tolerate inflation above target for long, as pointed in the decision statement. Thus, and this unemployment report today, although it would be a sign that the economic recovery continues, may raise speculation that interest rates in the US may rise somewhat faster than previously anticipated. Something like that may prove positive for the US dollar, but negative for equities. Equity investors may prefer extra loose monetary policy for longer, as this means cheap loans for companies. Now, flying from the US to the UK, the British pound was the main loser among the G10 currencies, coming under strong selling interest following headlines that the EU and the UK failed to close their differences gap in the latest round of trade talks, and that the EU began legal proceedings over the UK's plan to override key elements of the withdrawal agreement. Remember that on Monday, headlines hit the wires that a final trade accord was possible in this round of talks, with one EU official noting last week that the deal is 90% there. This helped the pound to sail north, but yesterday's news have diminished any hopes with regards to a trade deal before the upcoming EU summit, something which brings back to the table the prospect of a no-deal Brexit at the end of the year when the transition period expires. Now, as for the rest of today's events, during the European morning we get the preliminary Eurozone inflation data for September. According to some economic calendars, the data was scheduled for Wednesday, but it was not released. In any case, the headline rate is forecast to have held steady at minus 0.2% year over year, while no forecast is available for the core one. That said, the HICP, excluding food and energy metric, is expected to have accelerated to 1.1% year over year from 0.6%. Bearing in mind that both the German CPI and HICP rates slid more than anticipated, entering negative waters, we see the risks surrounding the bloc's headline. The bloc's headline rate has tilted to the downside. At the prior ECB meeting, policymakers kept monetary policy untouched, reiterating that they stand ready to adjust all their instruments as appropriate to ensure that inflation moves towards its aim in a sustained manner. Following the worse than expected PMIs for September, with the services sector slipping into contraction, a further decline of the headline CPI to the negative territory may increase speculation for additional stimulus by the ECB. However, the fact that the core HICP rate is expected to have accelerated means that the weak headline CPI rate may be the result of declines in energy and food, which may allow policymakers to wait for a while more before they decide to push the easing button. They may prefer to wait and see whether the deflationary rate is something temporary or not. Now, in the US, apart from the official employment data, we also get the factory orders for August and the final University of Michigan Consumer Sentiment Index for September. As for the speakers, we have two on today's schedule, and those are ECB Vice President Luis de Guindos and Philadelphia Fed President Patrick Harker. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, a greater weekend, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again next week.
JFT, just fair and direct.